السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. حي على الصلاة. حي على الصلاة. حي على الفلاح. حي على الفلاح. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
إن الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله، فصلى الله عليه صلاة وسلاما يليقان بمقام سيد الأنبياء وإمام المرسلين. My dear respected brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds all of us about taqwa, about being conscious about Him. And He says, بعد أن أعود بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. And Allah says, لتبلغن في أموالكم وأنفسكم ولتسمعن من الذين أوتوا الكتاب من قبلكم ومن الذين أشركوا أذى كثيرا. Allah is saying that you will be tested with your wealth and with your own lives. And you are going to hear a lot of nonsense, a lot of hurtful comments, a lot of insults from those who were given the book before you, and from the disbelievers, from the pagans, from the mushrikeen. And Allah tells us, وَإِن تَصْبِرُوا وَتَتَّقُوا فَإِنَّ ذَلِكَ مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. If you have patience and you have taqwa, conscious about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and protect yourself, you know, from his anger, then this is definitely the most desirable thing to do. My dear respected brothers and sisters, today I will be talking about three insults that were directed towards our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Three levels of insult from three different categories of people. And instead of talking about the negatives, I will be focusing on three opportunities that are given for Muslims like me and you. Three levels of insult opposed by three opportunities for all of us, inshallah, to defend Islam and to present the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The first insult, all of us know about it. The Charlie Hebdo caricatures and cartoons depicting our beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and before that the Danish cartoons, and before that a lot of what's so-called free speech against Islam, against the Quran, against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, insulting our beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the opportunity, because we are focusing about the positives here, is this is an opportunity for us to talk to the West, to talk to the media, to talk to the free people in this country about redefining what we know as freedom of speech. Is it true that even the West themselves, they have ultimate, unlimited freedom of speech? Inshallah, we'll be talking about it. So that's the first insult. The second insult is from some Muslims. Some Muslims, very few minority. They can't even, you can't even consider them a percentage. But those Muslims are the fanatic Muslims. Those who have a violent interpretation of Islam, of the Quran, of the seerah, of the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And let's be honest, those who think it's a conspiracy theory, I agree, it smells like a conspiracy, but there are some Muslims who justify these acts, who justify taking our revenge to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with the edge of the sword, would just kill anyone who opposes us. So there are some Muslims, and we have to be honest and frank with ourselves and try to talk about, with those Muslims, open an inter-Muslim debate. So I had an article this day, the other day, about how the Prophet ﷺ would react to these insults. And I listed some incidents from the seerah that I will share with you today. And I get this email from a non-Muslim lady who thanked me for the article and told me, Brother Muhammad or Muhammad, why don't you talk to the Muslim, the fellow Muslim, to Al-Qaeda, to those people who are actually taking the seerah and the life of Muhammad ﷺ and the Quran out of context. And I told her, you're 100% right. We should not only talk to the others, we should talk within ourselves. And the third level of insult, and I'm gonna be frank here, the third level of insult that these events, you know, exposed, is from the majority of the Muslims who were indifferent for anything that happened, who maybe condemned the killing of, you know, the media figures and the journalists. And they condemn the hate speech by Charlie Hebdo and others, but they do nothing. And those are the majority of Muslims. Those are almost every other Muslim who are indifferent, who are not doing anything, who are saying basically, I don't care, who are not doing anything. And for those, the third opportunity is to reignite the love of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our heart. Number two, to study the seerah in depth, and in a critical mindset to study the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For those Muslims, they have to be an opportunity to be a walking example of the Quran, as Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was, كان قرآنا يمشي على الأرض. And for those Muslims, there's an opportunity to revive at least one sunnah in your life and reignite the love and the following, المتابعة to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And for those Muslims who might be your next door neighbor, might be your cousin, might be your mother or father or sister, for those Muslims, I remind them with the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah At-Tawbah, Allah is telling His beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قُلْ إِن كَانَ آبَاؤُكُمْ وَأَبْنَاؤُكُمْ وَإِخْوَانُكُمْ وَأَزْوَاجُكُمْ وَعَشِيرَتُكُمْ وأموال اقترفتموها وتجارة تخشون كسادها ومساكن ترضونها أحب إليكم من الله ورسوله وجهاد في سبيله فتربصوا. Allah is telling Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, tell the believers, this ayah is not talking to non-believers, tell the believers, if your fathers and your sons and your spouses and your brothers and sisters and family relations and the business that you are afraid to lose and the houses and mansions you are living in, if all of those worldly matters that are halal, Allah is not talking about haram entities in our life. Allah is talking about halal entities and relations in our lives. But if those things are more beloved to you than Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and struggling and striving in the way of Allah, وَجِهَادٍ فِي سَبِيلِهِ, فتربصوا حتى يأتي الله بأمره. Then hold, then just wait. Wait until the punishment of Allah comes to you in a way that you will not even anticipate, because you are not, you don't have this passion, you don't have this, you know, energy, this love towards Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. When you see people trashing and talking about him, and when you see other people who claim to defend him and they are causing more harm to Muslims and to Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. When we talk about freedom of speech, when we talk about hate speech, it's not only happening in Europe. It's not only happening in France. It came to us here in the US under this so-called movie called American Sniper, that is depicting Muslims as terrorists, that's depicting Muslims as insane human, you know, inhuman creatures who are only waiting for other people to kill. And if you just see the comments on social media from non-Muslims saying after they watch the movie, I cannot wait to kill so-and-so Muslim or Arab or what have you. We are facing a lot of hate speech people. And being living in Dearborn, where we have majority of Muslims, is not, does not protect us. Because many Muslim brothers and sisters all over the nation, they are under threat. That's what we have to work on. It's not enough to remain silent anymore. But first, we talked about three insults and we talked about three opportunities. The first one is to redefine the freedom of speech. And we have to talk to the West, and we have to talk to the media, and we have to talk to all of the free people in the world and tell them there is nothing as ultimate, unlimited free speech in this world. Every society has its own constraints. Every society has its own limits when it comes to free speech. As we speak right now, there are some journalists in France that are in jail because they had some anti-Semitic comments criticizing the Jews, denying the Holocaust, denying the numbers in the Holocaust. So these are in jail. 16 countries in Europe, they think that this is something, you know, this is a big crime to deny the numbers in the Holocaust. While in the US, we don't have it, we don't have this law, but we are sympathizing in the US. So anti-Semitic comments or speech is prohibited. Some communities, they don't have legal repercussions for some comments or for some, you know, anti-Semitic comments, but there are always some social repercussions. Many CEOs, many, you know, coaches, many important figures, they cannot make any sexist comments, any, you know, comment against homosexuals. And if they do this, they will lose their position, they will lose their status, their power. They are not invited anymore. They are sold. They are forced to do so. Subhanallah, every society has its limits. Every society considers something that's taboo, that you should not cross it. Subhanallah, when it comes to Muslims, everything is allowed. There is no sacred, there is no red lines. And this is because of us. Maybe because it's the way we carry ourselves. I know my khutbah today is a little bit negative, is a little bit harsh. But we have to face the reality. The first step in solving the problem is to understand that we do have a problem. So this is the first opportunity. And I invite all of us to start, you know, talking to our non-Muslim friends and within the Muslims, to really identify what are the red limits and what should be the red limits. And you will be surprised that, subhanAllah, most of the non-Muslims are peaceful people. They don't carry those, you know, extreme agendas of insulting others and hate speech. But we have to start this debate and inshallah defend our rights to be respected, and at the same time defend and make it clear that Islam says clearly, لا إكراه في الدين. We don't force our ideas on others, but also we expect others to respect us and not to force their ideas on us. So that was number one. Number two, the second opportunity in my khutbah today is a discussion, an open discussion with the fanatic Muslims. With those who adopt a very violent version of Islam, a very violent interpretation of the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I'm going to comment very quickly on incidents where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how he reacted to those who defamed him in the media. The first incident in Mecca, where the Muslims were persecuted in a situation that's very similar to our situation nowadays, when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was defamed by a very famous poet. Her name was Ummu Jamil bint Harb. Most of our Muslim brothers, even my kids, they know her as Imra'at Abu Lahab. She's the wife of Abu Lahab. And Allah mentioned her in the Quran, وَامْرَأَتُهُ حَمَّالَةَ الْحَطَبِ فِي جِيدِهَا حَبْلٌ مِّنْ مَسَدٍ. This lady, Ummu Jamil bint Harb, was known for his very filthy poetry against Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I want you to imagine that poetry was a big thing at their time. Poetry was the weapon that, because it rhymes and it's, you know, it's easy to memorize, and they had very good memory. So everyone who hears a verse of poetry, they will memorize it and they will repeat it over and over and over. So subhanAllah, she made some poetry, and I am really ashamed even to mention the poetry of Umm Jamil bint Harb. But inshallah, I'm trying to make a point here. So she first of all, she twisted the name of our beloved Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam from Muhammad to Muzammam. So Muhammad means the praised one sallallahu alaihi wasallam. يَحْمَدُهُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Then she made his name Muzammam, the insulted one. And she made this filthy poetry, and I feel as if I am retweeting or reposting whatever cartoons, but subhanAllah, trying to make a point. So she said, مُذَمَّمًا عَصَيْنَا وَأَمْرَهُ قَلَيْنَا وَدِينَهُ أَبَيْنَا. We refused him and his religion, and we abandoned his call and what have you. And you can imagine the Sahaba hearing all of this poetry over and over and over. From the children, from the adults, from men, from women, from slaves, from free people. They were crazy. They went to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What can we do? This is media. This is a war of words. This is a war of media. So he faced all that with a smile, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, أَلَا تَعْجَبُونَ كَيْفَ يَصْرِفُ اللَّهُ عَنِّي أَذَى قُرَيْشٍ. Aren't you amazed how Allah is protecting me from all the harm, from all the hurtful comments of Quraysh? They are insulting a guy named Muzammam, and my name is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. So the first step in reacting to any comment, to any insult, to anything in the media is calm down. Don't let your anger drive your reactions. You have to calm down, you have to be rational. The Prophet ﷺ did not stay, you know, passive. But he didn't react out of violence, out of anger, out of just tell them anything. Let's go and kill Imra'atu Abu Lahab or Abi Lahab himself. No, he didn't. You have to be smart about it. If you kill Abu Lahab, somebody else will come and will have a worse kind of poetry. You have to be smart in your reaction. You have to act based on reason and logic, not based on emotions. That's number one. Now, someone might argue that the Prophet ﷺ was weak in Mecca, but when he becomes powerful in Medina, he will do something more violent. Let's see this. In Medina, there was a lot of wars happening in Medina, where the small Muslim state was in Medina and in Mecca, and many poets in Mecca were defaming the Prophet ﷺ. And guess what? Some of those poetry, we don't know about them. Why? Because the Sahaba didn't keep on mentioning them over and over and over. They just, as Umar ibn al-Khattab says, أَمِيتُ الْبَاطِلَ بِالسُّكُوتِ عَنْهِ. Let it wither and die away. Let's not always share it and talk about it more and more and more. So this is when the Prophet ﷺ was calling for action. Come on, ya Sahaba. Come on, my dear companions. I need someone to reply back to Quraysh. In the same media, in the same you know, instrument, which is poetry. And this is where Hassan ibn Thabit al-Ansari came. And he made some amazing poetry defending Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and rebuking Quraysh. And he was asking, what is the thing that will make Quraysh very angry? That will get to their nerves in my poetry? So he said, I'm not going to defame their idol worshipping, for example. But they are proud of it. They are proud of being idol worshippers. Let me do something else. So he started pulling out history and remembering the battles where Quraysh were defeated. And he started to pull out their lineages and their forefathers, because the thing that was very sacred for the Quraysh was their forefathers. He's like, let me pull all their lineage and family trees and defame them one by one. That was a big insult for Arabs at the time. But the Prophet ﷺ told him, hey, just a second. I am from Quraysh. I have some common lineage with Quraysh. If you mention any of my forefathers in a bad way, then you will be insulting me and them. Then Hassan ibn Thabit al-Ansari had to do teamwork with another expert, with another man who was very good, who was an expert in lineage, and there was no one other than Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu, who had a teamwork, and they produced an amazing, you know, media, an amazing media production, which was the verses of Hassan ibn Thabit that avoided the lineage of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. When the Quraysh read this poetry, they were extremely angry. They stopped whatever they are doing and they said, Subhanallah, this cannot be Hassan ibn Thabit alone. There should be someone from Mecca who is helping him. And that was Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. So Islam is all about being perfecting what you do. Doing things out of reason, out of logic, and doing things while you know where you are heading. The Prophet ﷺ told Hassan ibn Thabit that your poetry is harsher on Quraysh than the shooting of arrows and the edges of the sword. It's harsher on them. Listen to this, dear respected Muslim brothers who are adopting a fanatic and violent version of Islam. It's harsher on them to reply with a decent, with a professional media than to just go and kill one or two people. It's harsher on them. And the Prophet ﷺ made an amazing dua to Hassan ibn Thabit. He told him, "Uhjuhum wa ruhu al-Qudus ma'ak." Go harsh on them with your poetry and the Holy Spirit, Angel Jibreel, will be with you. Allahu Akbar. Angel Jibreel, the angel who only comes down for revelation, for new ayat of the Quran. Angel Jibreel is the one who came to Maryam to announce the birth of Isa ibn Maryam. Angel Jibreel is actually one of his extra side missions is to support Hassan ibn Thabit. And as our scholars say, he is to support any poet, any media man, any person who defends the honor of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So my dear Muslims living in Dearborn, Michigan, and living in the US, it's our chance to get the dua and to get the support of Hassan, and to be like Hassan ibn Thabit, and to get the support from Angel Jibreel if we present some media work that is amazing, that's profound, that is strong, and that defends our Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As an example, just to be practical, some brothers, subhanallah, Brother Muhammad Ziyara is a well-known figure on Facebook, and Sheikh Omar Sulaiman, one of the great scholars, they produced a series called Inspiration. And I invite all of my brothers and sisters to watch it online. Inspiration series. They take one hadith and they make a story, a video out of this hadith. And they present the manners of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a way that's very close to how Hassan ibn Thabit was presenting the strength and honor of Islam. We are proud today that we have one of our sisters in this masjid, in this community, who accepted Islam after watching one of those series. Accepted Islam after watching the Inspiration series. She's not the first one, and she won't be the last one, but we have to do our part. And that's why my urge, my invitation to all of our brothers and sisters is to start being rational and start having a total plan in order to present Islam and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Lastly, inshallah, there's a big comment, there's a big controversy that some Western scholars and some, you know, Islamophobes raised about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordering the killing of Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf, who was a Jew and who was a poet and who defamed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with a very filthy poetry. And this, you will see it in any Islamophobic website. Every time they mention about Islam being intolerant, Islam against freedom of speech, Islam being anti-Semitic, they bring the story of Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf. Well, if you open the book of Sirah, and I have a small article which I refer to, it's on the website on Islam. The title of the article is, "Did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam approve assassinations?" And I try to cover this in more depth. But to give you a snapshot of this article, is Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf, he was a citizen in the state of Medina. He was one of those figures in the Jewish community who signed the treaty with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the state of Medina, that the Medina state was kind of a federal system where every tribe, every faith have their own system. But when it comes to defending the security of the state of Medina, they all report to the leader Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there is no communication with the external enemy, which is Quraysh. Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf denounced all of this, as if he like burnt his Medina passport. And he went to Mecca, and he communicated with the enemies, Abu Sufyan at that time, before he became a Muslim. Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf actually started lobbying many Arabs and many Jewish tribes to gather them to war against the Muslims. Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf actually had a lot of verses of poetry defaming the chastity of the women of the Sahaba by name. So he was a very extreme, special case, and he was a man who was calling for an all-out war against Islam and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is where the wisdom of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes. where he tries to avoid as much as possible the a lot of battles, a lot of wars that will cause a lot of casualties on both the Muslim side and the non-Muslim side. He sent a few Sahaba with a very specific command: go and assassinate this person, Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf. من لي بكعب ibn al-Ashraf فإنه قد آذى الله ورسوله. And those Sahaba go, and after he dies, subhanAllah, all the tribes and all the wars that were about to happen, they all died down. The Prophet ﷺ was not Gandhi. He was not this person who does not engage in war whatsoever. This is not realistic. But he was not a violent leader. He was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a mercy to mankind. And sometimes mercy means I have to use power against specific individuals in order to remove harm from a lot more people, subhanAllah. And this is why in all of the seerah, in the 23 years of the seerah, in almost 10 years of, you know, politics and wars with the Quraysh and with the non-believers, the total number of casualties in the seerah, less than 1,000. On both Muslim side and non-Muslim side. And you might say, oh, because they had few numbers at that time. No, look at the numbers and the figures in the Roman and Persian wars. In the thousands. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one who knows how to use war and how to use the weapon and how to use battlefield in its proportion, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he is mercy to mankind. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make the three insults that came to Islam, three opportunities for us to defend Islam and present our deen and present our rahmah to mankind. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه فيا فوز المستغفرين. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى لا سيما نبينا المصطفى ومن بسنته وآثاره اقتدى واقتفى واقتفى. My dear respected brothers and sisters, we talk about three insults happening to Islam and the Muslims. The first one from the so-called free speech media that only knows free speech when it comes to attacking and defaming Islam and Muslims and the Prophet ﷺ. That's the first insult. The second insult from a minority of Muslims who thought that the only way to revenge to Muhammad ﷺ يعني is by actually responding in a violent manner. And the third level of insult is by the majority of Muslims who were indifferent. And inshallah, people in this community, inshallah, people in this masjid won't be from those. Inshallah, people in this masjid will be from those who will defend Islam and who will present Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the manners of Islam in an amazing way. And one of the quick ways to do this is to be a walking example of Islam, of the Quran. As Sayyidah Aisha said about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كان قرآنا يمشي على الأرض. To be a walking example of the Quran, to present Islam in your manners. SubhanAllah, some incident happened in this area maybe a year ago, where there was this soccer league in Novi, and there were some team from Dearborn and another team from a different city. And SubhanAllah, what happened is it became very aggressive, the game. So one of the Dearborn team, he basically reacted in a very violent way and punched the referee. Just because of a game. And the referee was wounded and injured heavily. Goes to the hospital, and subhanAllah, he dies out of injury. Very, very sad incident. And that's not my concern, because I would say it happens, but my concern was, when I was reading on the news, my concern was the comments, the huge insults from people, other non-Muslims in the area, saying, oh, those Muslims, they are this and that. Yeah, I treated with them. They do this in business. They cheat on food stamps. They do this. My concern is we have to need a lot of work. You need, subhanAllah, for every negative incident, for every problem that happens, we have to do maybe 5 to 10 times more. And I'm not saying being apologetic. I'm saying be who we are. I'm saying be true followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm saying treating people with our manners. I'm saying like this brother that I know personally, who had an accident with another lady. And when they had this accident, subhanAllah, he didn't have to fix for her anything. But because she was poor and she was, you know, in a very, you know, difficult situation, he told her, you know what, I'm going to fix this for you. And he fixed it. And after everything, and the lady was surprised. How can someone with no commitments, no paperwork, no whatsoever, pay me $300 for my car that's worth only $600? But then he told her, I did this because of this. Because of the Quran. Because of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because of the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Did she embrace Islam or not? It's not my business. It's not his business. It's your business to be who you are. To be a Muslim. to be a true follower of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. See, people cannot see the iman in your heart and my heart, but they can see your actions. They can see how you react when you are angry. They can see how you react when there's a problem at home. They can see how you treat your children. They can see how you treat your business partners. They can see how you treat your customers. They can see how you treat the government, your taxes, and what have you. My dear respected brothers and sisters, it's our chance to be true followers of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to reply to any insult, to any problem, to any incident with a smile, with the way that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam reacted. The Islam was not spread by the sword. Islam was spread by the manners of the Muslims, by the manners of the Yemeni merchants who traveled from Yemen to Indonesia and this part of the world, and they spread Islam, and now it's the largest Muslim population in the world. Not by the sword, not by battlefields, not by all-out war. It's about the manners. And it's about time, inshallah. I have high hopes in all of us in this room. I have high hope that the Dearborn Muslims and the Michigan Muslims will make the difference بإذن الله سبحانه وتعالى. If we go back and reignite the love of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and revive a sunnah in our heart and study the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and become walking examples of the Quran. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على قوم الكافرين وانصرنا على قوم الظالمين وانصرنا على قوم المعتدين. اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا وجعلنا سببا لمن اهتدى واهد الناس على ايدينا. اللهم اجعلنا هداة مهديين غير ضالين ولا مضلين سلما لاوليائك حرما على ادائك يا رب العالمين. اللهم اجعلنا من اهل القران الذين هم اهلك وخاصتك. اللهم البسنا به الحلل واسكننا به الظلل ودفع عنا به النقم واجعلنا به عند النعماء من الشاكرين وعند البلاء من الصابرين. ربنا اغفر لنا ولوالدينا، رب ارحمهما كما ربونا صغارا، ربنا اجعلنا نقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتنا، ربنا وتقبل دعاء. ربنا اغفر لنا ولوالدينا وللمؤمنين يوم يقوم الحساب، وصل اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، والحمد لله رب العالمين، وأقم الصلاة إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر.
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله.